Brother Dave.
Hello, Brother Mel.
What a pleasure to have you here. I suggest that we do all of our advertisements at the beginning. Let's get it all over with. You're here today, the guest of our creative thinking class at Cholon Institute of Technology. We're here in our new creative space. Used to be the television studios, and after 20 years, today is the day that we are
revisiting.
So, yes, we're revisiting.
Reenacting.
And this is going to
reviewing.
Be, yes, no. And this is reinstating. And this is going to be now the creative space of the college. And we're also going to interview luminary people such as yourself. So we are now we did that already. Okay. So David, let's do all the advertisements. You are now the chief economist of Gluskin Sheff.
Chief economist and strategist.
Now, when did that happen?
The day I started there.
Okay, good to know. Chief economist.
They wanted to make the economics relevant.
I guess so. So you're also in charge of strategy.
Thank you.
Okay, good. Gluskin Sheff, where it's a bank in Canada.
It's a wealth management firm.
Wealth management, and you can open an account if you have.
Well, it's not cut and dry, but. $3 million.
It says on the internet.
That's why I'm here.
Yeah.
So, all these wealthy future people. That's why they're going to school.
So all our students here are going to run and open an account. But like, if you have like $2.5 million, like if I bring you $2.5 million, will you cut me a deal?
If you're nice to me.
Okay, that's brotherly love. And Gluskin Sheff was kind enough to lend us you.
Well, actually, I'm here on vacation for. Our niece's wedding.
Absolutely.
So this is Chofesh, but I don't think they'll mind.
No, but they cut us a freebie.
A freebie? Why?
Well, because you didn't know that we're not going to pay you.
I didn't expect you were going to pay me.
Okay, but
I was expecting a free beer sign outside though.
No, free beer is afterwards.
Okay, good.
We don't allow beer on our campus. We have the CEO sitting here, and he's very careful about that.
Okay. Non-alcoholic beer.
Non-alcoholic beer. And so you're getting me off track here already, Dave.
That's started. That's the point of the interviewee, okay. Is to get the interviewer off track.
So we already did the advertisement for Gluskin Sheff and the deep discount because you usually charge $25,000 for giving a talk.
Well, that's again, there's a gray area.
Okay, so we're in the black area of the gray area.
That's right. This was a pro bono.
Pro bono.
So family discount.
That's right. And before you were at Gluskin Sheff, you were the chief economist and strategist?
No,
North
just,
America?
Just chief economist.
Okay. Of a company that was once called Merrill Lynch.
That's right.
And I want to start out by taking you back to the summer of 2007, when you are one of the few mavericks in the world who are afraid of the impending doom of the recession. And warning everybody. And here in Israel, I wake up one morning and I'm reading my Newsweek or Time magazine, and they are trashing you. And I'm reading Newsweek or Time, I don't remember, maybe it's better that I don't remember. And I read about my own brother at Merrill Lynch, saying how everything is terrible, the economy is terrible, and why are you such a bear when everything is rosy. Not Rosie Rosenberg, but rosy. And I'm feeling for you. How did you feel during those, let's say, year and a half when you were one of the only people waving the flag of recession coming on?
Well, it's a it's a lonely feeling. There's no question about that. But look, the reality is that in my profession, you do your homework and you get paid to make forecasts. And sometimes it's not going to be very popular. It certainly was not a very popular forecast to be forecasting a bear market and a recession. It's not the first time that I've done that, because I did the same thing in 2000 during the tech wreck.
Were you right then?
I have this history of being able to use a weather analogy. I do a much better job forecasting stormy weather than sunshine. But I know a bear market and a recession when I see one. And I saw all the makings for a recession, and that there was a massive bubble in the U.S. housing market and in the credit markets.
When did you start screaming?
Well, it was, the pitch got different over time. But I started getting more concerned, say, in 2005, 2006. So I was very early on the call, but I'd say by 2007, I was getting all sorts of other market signals telling me that, you know, that something insidious was going to happen. But it's like everything, you know, a lot of the developments in my industry, say in the markets and the economy, you know, the markets and the economy have the symbiotic relationship. But a lot of the time it's just lags. You know, you don't want to be too early on your calls. But this is a very big call because it was a call really for a collapse in something that's very important for the economy and for people's lives, which is housing, and in credit. It turned out to be even worse than I thought it was going to be. But, you know, people naturally, because I think that we're naturally optimistic. I think human beings are naturally optimistic.
That's where we go wrong in predicting the economy.
Well, it's a matter of when you're making a call that is unpopular, a call that's going to, you know, that it's not your call that's causing the pain, but you're making a call that something's going to happen that if you're not prepared, it is going to be very painful. And look how painful it was. And of course, it went viral. I mean, it went global. And so you're not actually a very popular person when you make that sort of a forecast.
So you weren't too popular.
I was not too popular. They used to actually call me at Merrill Lynch. My nickname was the skunk at the picnic.
The skunk at the picnic.
Who wants to have lunch with a skunk?
Okay. So and Merrill Lynch, which you represented in those days, made a living in selling and buying stocks.
Yeah.
And you told all the customers of Merrill Lynch to sell their stocks. In one word.
Well, sell stocks and buy bonds or move into cash.
Yeah. So you weren't very popular.
I was not very popular. That's true.
Okay. And now that you've reversed your views over the past year and a half, 2 years, you're again unpopular.
Well, it's you know, it's a no-win situation. So I turned. I'd say in the fall of 2012, I started becoming, shall we say, become less pessimistic, and then there's a fine line between that, and then more optimistic. Mm-hmm. And you know, people have always viewed me as this perma bear. In fact, I was interviewed in Toronto recently on the Business News Network, and the anchor, when we were off camera, said, "So how does it feel to have morphed from being a perma bear to a perma bull?" And I said, "That is the most moronic, oxymoronic thing anybody's ever said to me." And I said, "It's a good thing we're off camera because I'd call you out on it." So the anchor says, "What are you talking about?" I said, "Well, if I was a perma bear, how could I become a perma bull? Because perma, by definition, means you're just never going to change your view." My situation was that when I started working at Merrill, and this was before Merrill US, when I was the chief economist and strategist at Merrill Lynch Canada, starting in 2000, I started right at the peak of the tech mania. And I did not get sucked into that situation. I knew that that was another bubble that was going to end badly. But all of a sudden, I had a pedestal, and I was on TV a lot. And then, of course, we have that crash. And then I predict the next crash, and people just remember you as being, you're always just negative. You're always just negative, always just negative. But before 2000, you know, when I was in relative obscurity, working as a junior economist and an intermediate economist, back in the 1980s at the Bank of Nova Scotia, and then at the 1990s at the Bank of Montreal, we were actually very positive. But I was actually helping the chief economist back then make the calls, but nobody would know that, you know, this guy, David Rosenberg, actually has a history of actually being positive. He's not a perma bear, he's not a perma bull. You just basically call them as you see them. So my job is to help our clients, okay? My job, you know, whatever the general population wants to do, they can do. My job at Merrill Lynch was to help our clients make money or save money. Today I work at Gluskin Sheff. The client base is different. My job is to help people make money and help them save money. So what some reporter says in the newspaper or what other people might want to think about me, if you want to know the truth, I don't care.
Okay.
They're not my constituents.
Okay. So we're talking today about the DNA of success. Okay. And I wanted to start out with this. You are, as an economist, thick-skinned. You're not afraid to call the shots as you see them. And at Merrill Lynch, they were not happy. There's even a rumor that they didn't send your emails to all your customers. And they tried even to stifle you for a time.
Well, I have no evidence of that one way or the other. I had an unpopular view, that much is true.
If Merrill Lynch had listened to you, would they still be here?
Well,
they,
was,
by the way, are not here anymore.
No, but it was, you know, that's a very complicated, there's no easy answer to that if they would have listened to me. That's really tough to say. And all I can say is that you talk about being thick-skinned. You know, it's either you're going to take on this responsibility of being an economist and a strategist, okay? So I'm first and foremost an economist, but I tie it into, I make market calls out of the economics. So look, you can be an economist at the Bank of Israel, or the Fed or the Bank of Canada. You can be an economist in academia. You can go work at the Conference Board. You can go work at the Brookings Institute. But if you're going to be on Wall Street or on Bay Street or Boylston Street or Montgomery Street or Howe Street, whatever the street, if you're going to be a street economist, you're going to be a market economist, you have to call them as you see them and be impervious to all the other noise out there, whether it's criticism. And if you're in the public eye, you're going to just have to get used to it. If you don't have a thick skin in my profession, you're not helping out your clients. If you're going to be sensitive to what other people think about you or what some reporter says about you, and you're going to be influenced by that, you're not doing your job. Your job is basically to take the economic information, your lens, your assumptions, and formulating a cogent investment strategy out of it for the benefit of the people that are paying your firm. That's your responsibility. So if you have a thin skin in my profession, then you're going to get easily pushed off course, and you're not going to be doing a service to the people that rely on you. So I just basically block that out. Yeah, so being a thick-skinned is actually 100% part of the job to do it effectively.
Okay, I would like to take that a bit farther because I've known you for all of your life. I think that if we're talking about DNA of success, okay, it's not only being an economist. I think that in most professions, you have to believe in yourself and you have to have thick skin and you have to be prepared to suffer criticisms and to move on with your belief. So let's take it way back to you as a young child.
Okay.
Where did we grow up?
In Ottawa, Canada.
That's right.
The nation's capital.
Yeah, we didn't grow up on Wall Street. And we'll talk about your youth in a minute, but let's talk about where you are today. You send out a morning newsletter to 90,000 economists all over the world, which is, on days of Chometz, it's called Breakfast with Dave. But on Pesach, it's called?
Matzah with Dave.
And on Chanukah?
Latkes with Dave.
Okay.
But he didn't ask me about Yom Kippur.
Okay, Yom Kippur.
Yeah, that's Kol Nidre with Dave.
Is it?
It's agony with Dave.
Come on.
It's where's my coffee hit with Dave.
It's the fast track.
Ah, that's good.
Okay.
It's not 90,000 economists, by the way. It's just 90,000
people. Oh, okay.
And it's and there's a précis, there's a short version, and then there's a longer version, which has 2,500 paying subscribers.
Well, that's your business model.
That's the business model.
And you asked me not to talk about how many millions of dollars accrue from that.
Well, because I'm humble and shy.
Oh, what I can say. Almost $3 million.
But you're not humble and shy, so you could say it.
Almost $3 million a year just from David's newsletter. That's some brother. And you were recently at the Senate in the United States?
The Senate Budget Committee.
The Senate Budget Committee invited you, a Jewish boy from Ottawa, a Canadian, to tell them what's going to happen in America. That's something.
Well, you know... Well, it was it was an honor to be there. A lot of it was because they also wanted a Canadian. Because most people probably wouldn't know this. They certainly didn't know that Canada in the early 1990s almost went bankrupt. Canada was basically, it's a bit of a stretch, but Canada was almost like a cross between Greece and Spain and Italy back in the early 1990s. Canada had a huge budgetary deficit, was becoming very structural in nature, huge current account deficit, and the Canadian dollar was going down, 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 and it was forcing interest rates up, 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 up. And we had a bit of a financial crisis in Canada back in the early to mid-1990s. And the government of the day back in 1995 dramatically changed course. and embarked on years of fiscal reforms to the point where Canada has got about the strongest government balance sheet and the federal government balance sheet in the world. So Canada is basically a poster child, as they would say, for fiscal reform, which the U.S. dramatically needs. When you take a look at their future in terms of Social Security and Medicare, their entitlements, that's a ticking time bomb for them. So they wanted, so part of it was also being, you know, a Canadian representative almost, to talk about the what Canada did to embark on these very painful structural reforms and how they managed to do it and make it politically feasible at the same time.
Yeah. For many years, you've been the number one Canadian analyst in various categories and one of the top in the United States also. So you have this unique view of being able to blend your view of Canada and your world of the, your view of the United States. But I'm going to take you now outside your comfort zone. So here I have a baby brother, right, who's world famous. You were on the front page of the Wall Street Journal of Business a couple of months ago. I mean, you're stellar, right? And one of the things that we want to discuss is, okay, when I ask students, and ask students, you know, what, do they want to come to meet you? And their reaction, I said, what would you like to ask David about his career? And they said, oh, not very much, really. You must have had a wealthy parents, famous connections, or very lucky. And that's a very myopic way to describe your life and your success. What can you say about the home that you grew up in as a very young kid?
It was a, you know, it was a loving home.
And you have to tell the truth because I'm here.
No, that's a, you know, I'll say that. For example, what are the things that I picked up? Because I think that if we're going to talk about how you become successful, however you want to define what success is, because I have a particular definition of it. A lot of it is when the people that you meet, the people that have influenced you in your life. And of course, if we're going to talk about my parents, you know, you don't choose your parents. But what you can choose to do is take their best qualities and model yourself after them. I look at my parents, for example, and when I think about them, I think about leadership. And because that's a critical characteristic of being successful is proving that you can be a leader. My mother was a kindergarten teacher, and I think she was a natural leader. And
she was actually embarrassed to be a kindergarten teacher, even though she changed the lives of hundreds of kids.
Yeah, and I used to go shopping with her in the shopping center in Ottawa when I was a teenager, and there would be people in their 30s and 40s running up to her saying, Gananet Rosenberg. But the thing is that she was a leader. It's not that she was just a kindergarten teacher. You've got a situation now where more and more politicians, and you're seeing this in New York, for example, under de Blasio, that are now taking taxpayer money and funding pre-kindergarten. Understanding that critical age of, you know, 4 or 5 years old. And so I thought of her as a leader. My dad was the only two-term president of Mexique Adas, which was the most prominent Orthodox synagogue in Ottawa. He was the only two-term president there. So when I think of my parents, I think of leadership. I think actually something that you had said earlier about being out of your comfort zone. And I think that if you're talking about how you can put yourself in a position, because luck has actually something to do with it as well, but how do you put yourself in that position to be lucky? And so that was interesting, your turn of phrase about being outside the comfort zone to me means how do you adapt to change? And my parents, at a young age, with you as a baby, left Winnipeg, and Winnipeg was like a shtetl, you know, it was actually the center of Judaism and Yiddish culture, Jewish culture, for decades in Canada. And in their early 20s, my parents left Winnipeg, and it was not an easy decision, and moved to Ottawa, where I was born. My dad got a job in the federal government. And that was very difficult. But that was basically the willingness to change and adapt to change. And they made a life for themselves in Ottawa. They had a tremendous number of friends. And they made a life for themselves, brought up four children in Ottawa. And then in the early 1980s, they made another change where they moved to Israel. And they did it on a one-year trial. And they went to Ulpan. And next thing you know, for the next 30 years, they made a whole new life for themselves in the Aretz. And so when I think about leadership, I think about adapting to change. I think about my mother in particular was so tenacious and was so determined in so many respects. And also was a tremendous communicator. You know, that's one of the benefits that I had growing up. So Mel's my only brother, and he's a professor. My mother was a kindergarten teacher. I have a sister, Miriam, and it's her daughter.
We both have a sister, Miriam.
We both have a sister, Miriam. Yeah, just by happenstance. And our niece, her daughter's getting married on Tuesday. And my sister, Miriam, is a teacher. And then I have another sister, Rena, who lives in Toronto as well. And she's both a nurse and a teacher. So there seems to have been, and my father, our father, taught at the University of Ottawa.
Same father.
Well, I just tend to find that, you know, so what's teaching all about? What's teaching? Really to elevate other people's ability to share knowledge, to communicate. If you can't communicate in my business, then there's something seriously wrong, okay? Communication skills are imperative. And not every teacher is a good teacher. I think everybody would agree that Mel is a superior communicator.
This is about you, David.
But I'm saying, but the thing is that there's no way that anybody who could ever say to you, I became a success on my own, is an absolute outright liar. Because nobody became a success on their own. Your success is basically the accumulation of all your experiences. And it's not just experiences with things, it's experiences with people and relationships, and who you decided who was going to be your mentor. Or if it wasn't your mentor, it was your friends, or it was your siblings, your parents. But I found it very interesting, and I had a leg up on everybody as a young person, because you want to go into the past, to have that ability to be around people that actually became pedagogues. Gave me a very great advantage to have a family that actually were teachers. I think rubbed off on me in terms of my ability to communicate. I think that gave me a leg up early on, in my opinion, when I look back.
Wow, you might as well just continue talking. You're hitting on all the right points. So you talked about learning from your parents, the positive attributes.
Yes.
We're not going to go into the other attributes today.
Nobody's perfect.
Exactly, but to hone in on the positive things about our house, where intellect was very important, communication was important, teaching and learning was important. That's quite amazing. But like, as a young kid, what were you like as a young kid? I mean, when you went through school, you didn't say someday I'm going to grow up and have a stellar career, did you?
No.
Well, tell them what you were like as a kid.
Well,
if you don't, I will. So.
Well, you know, it's
the positive thing.
Well, it's you know, how you view yourself and how other people view you can often there can often be a divide. I you know, people are surprised to know that when I was younger, my marks in school weren't so good. Your marks were phenomenal, Rena.
Until I got to university,
I used to actually. Mel was an enigma. Mel left home when I was 8 years old. And he had all these trophies because he was like a 98 student.
Because I was a nerd. I was the world's. I got David. I got once 88 on an exam, and like I did it again in order to get 90 something. I was the world's biggest nerd. I came to Israel. I was the worst student in Hebrew University. You know that. So let's call a spade a spade.
Okay. So in any event, I was more into sports. I love to play hockey. I love to play football. The only sport I actually played in a league was baseball.
Yeah.
Baseball was my third favorite sport, but I was good at it. And I played league ball till I was 18 years old. But I was always into sports. I like to hang around with my friends, I was just more of a bon vivant, I guess. I did not do well.
You were a young
school.
Bon vivant.
I was not. And my marks actually weren't that great. I didn't. You know, they weren't that great until grade 10. In grade 10, and I can give you an explanation. I don't know if it's the right one. My marks shot up like 25 percentage points, and a couple of things happened. I think that I actually did not like school at all. I hated school. I hated the school that I went to. We all went to the same school. I hated school. And I loved to be with my friends, and I loved to play sports, and I hated school. And what happened in grade 10 was I had a couple of very interesting courses, history and English, taught by Mr. Haiba. And he was a phenomenal communicator, a phenomenal teacher. And actually, I've got to go back to grade 10 to think about the first time I had a real positive experience scholastically in high school. My marks shot up, and they stayed high.
One second, just history or all across the board?
Well, it's interesting that it rubbed off on everything else. And so what happened was that I started becoming happier in my school life. Not that I gave up sports, but I became a lot happier. I became a lot happier in my school life, and my marks kept on going up. And the happier I got, the better my marks got. The better my marks got, the happier I got. And it was this, all of a sudden, this self-reinforcing spiral to the upside. A bull market. Well, you know, and so when I look back on that, because of course, you know, back then, it's like right now. We're living in the moment. And then years can pass by, and then you can really, you know, take a deep breath and assess what happened years ago. But it actually applies to when I give people career advice today. It's an example I actually give. I did not like school. I did poorly at school. I started doing well at school, and I started becoming happier. And it does build on itself. And so I realized in my younger years, I was not passionate at all about school. School was not a passion at all. Sports was a passion. I did well at sports. But all of a sudden, I developed a passion for school. Not that I loved getting up at like in the morning and going to school, but I developed a certain passion for it. And we can talk about how that translated towards economics. That happened over a period of time. But if you're going to be successful in whatever it is that you do, be passionate about what you do. Be passionate about it. It doesn't matter what it is. It doesn't matter how much money it makes you. That's immaterial, actually. It's basically, if you have passion for what you do and you're good at it naturally, you will be successful. But if the passion's not there, you'll live a miserable life.
How passionate are you, David? On a regular morning, a workday morning, what time do you get out of bed?
Let's call it 4:30.
And why do you get up every morning at 4:30 for dozens of years?
Well, you know, now we're getting a little personal.
As a professional.
It's too much tea the night before.
Yeah.
No, it's I get up and I do the my morning newsletter, Breakfast with Dave. So, got to get up, you know, get showered, get changed, have my coffee, drive to the office, and then...
Every time I ever stayed over with you, like at 4 in the morning, there's all these papers outside the door.
Yeah.
You know, the Japanese Times, the North Korean, whatever. Like, you're reading, like, Far East at 4 in the morning, and you're still passionate about it.
Well, that's part of the passion. You know, I get up, you know, again, so I'm in the business of economics, financial markets, and the financial markets nowadays, they don't go to sleep. And there's futures markets, and you know, Asia's open while everybody's sleeping, at least in North America. You know, I can't wait to get started. Every day, you see, and my industry is so dynamic. Every day, you know, is like a whole new day. A whole new day. New data come out, political developments come out. Somebody at the Fed, or somebody at the Bank of Canada, or it could be somebody at the Bank of Israel if you're following what's happening. It's every single day the financial markets are changing. the markets are changing all the time, and it's very dynamic. To me, it's very exciting. It's not for everybody. It takes a certain sort of type A personality, but it's constantly changing. And when I get up in the morning, I want to see. So sometimes I'll go straight to the Bloomberg machine and I'll see like what, because that's the thing, is that it's constantly changing, right? It's like somebody once told me. That's what I mean, is that when you connect yourself with mentors and with people that you respect, that you're learning from. And somebody once said to me that there's two things that you could basically be guaranteed, two things with certainty. One of them is death. Okay, but we won't talk about that.
We can talk about it.
As Woody Allen once said, it's not that I fear death, I just don't want to be around when it shows up. And the second is change. The second is change. And that's what I said before when I talked about my parents and their capacity to adapt to change. And so that's very important in the financial industry, because you have to cope with change. Now, to me, it's a huge challenge, because you're left with a situation where has there been enough change for you, and I'm talking about me, to change my forecast? Like at some point, because you have a forecast that's built on a lot of assumptions, right? Because I'm not a scientist like you. You're a scientist. I used to go to Mel's lab at University of Tel Aviv, and he had a real lab with cells and so on and so forth. Now, I'm an economist, which is not, it's a social science. It's an art, it's a science, it's a soft science, it's a social science. There's no laboratory, but much like your business, your assumptions drive your conclusions. That's when people say to me all the time, how could you get five economists in the same room and get five different answers? Well, here's the answer. Each one of them is operating on a different set of assumptions. And if you have a different set, you see, and that's the thing, is that you just tweak one little thing, and you're gonna get a different answer over here, because it's a whole forecasting, it's a whole process. So at what point does all this dynamic change cause you to change your view?
So you thrive on change, whereas most people who are your age thrive on routine. And you wake up in the morning, don't say what's the same, you say what could be different.
Right.
Okay, now I'm going to take you way back, okay, to 4-year-old David. I think as your brother, part of the reason that you're so successful is because you are intrepid. You have an intrepid gene. Now, I'm not going to brag about this because I did not inherit this intrepid gene, okay? Every time I know that I'm going to get on a plane, I start drinking. You travel all the time. You've flown on airplanes and had emergency landings, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you went back and you flew the next day. And if there's a little bit of turbulence, you just order another scotch, right?
True.
When you were 4 years old, we had in Canada a basement that was haunted. And it really was haunted. I did once see a ghost on the ground floor. So trust me, this house in Canada was haunted. And in the winter, the pipes would make all kinds of noises. And this is true. Because in Canada, pipes move during the winter. And besides that, there were ghosts of dead Inuits. Because, you know, Canadians sometimes have criticism for Israel, you know. But we killed all of the Indians and we lived on their land. And probably our house was built on a burial plot. And everybody knew that except David. So there's three kids. If you were four, I was 13. I was scared of everything. Rena was 9 and scared of most things. And Miriam was 7. And also scared because we told her that there were ghosts downstairs and she believed us. And we thought we were telling the truth. And what we would do is we'd say, David, go downstairs and make sure everything's okay. And what did you do?
I went downstairs.
Yeah, absolutely. From the age of 4, you were intrepid.
Well, I look at it this way. Another key to success is you just do what you're told. I was very obedient.
Okay.
Respected my elders.
Okay. So here's the thing. I want to get to a certain point here. You improved in high school. You went to University of Toronto, which was nice, but it wasn't Harvard or Stanford or MIT, right? You did your master's, but you didn't do your PhD. And you started your career working more or less for the Canadian government.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
Yep.
And you didn't have a top job. And I should say that, before I forget that, that as a high school student, we did have pull. You know, it's not true that we didn't have rich friends. And we used to get summer jobs working for the rich friends. Like doing what? Mowing the lawn?
Cleaning out empty apartments.
Yeah.
You know, yeah, that was spraying weeds.
That's right. And what did you learn from that? You became a socialist for a while.
Well, if you're going to be successful, you've got to deal with the failures, and learn from them. Well, that's again, you know, the thing is that if you're going to bring this down to success, is to because you know what, we're all flawed. And because we're human beings,
so you mean you were flawed for a year by being a socialist.
You have to learn from your mistakes.
Yeah,
and then try not to make the same mistake twice. Because that's
you got a job.
That's not acceptable.
You got a job working for wealthy friends of mom and dad.
Yeah,
carting fruits around, and you tried to unionize.
Well, I didn't on my own. I actually.
David, I know the story. So
well, you're telling it very well. Sort of. I think it needs some subtext here that I didn't start a union. I was involved in starting a union for this company that was a couple of fruit stores, large fruit stores in Ottawa.
Friend of our parents who gave you a summer job.
Great friends gave me a summer job.
$2 an
hour. As a favor to my dad.
$2 an hour.
And they mistreated their employees. It was actually one of the worst working environments I've ever seen. I was appalled and disappointed, and I was 20 years old and very idealistic. And so, I just finished first year university at University of Toronto, which it's not quite Harvard. That much is true, and I took this course in industrial relations. And I thought I was a real macher, you know, in industrial relations. I'm like, I understand labor management issues. I'm going to help. So I got asked to help out the people.
After taking the 101 course.
That's right, the 101 course. I was an expert. And then I ended up getting knee deep in that whole issue. And it was a mistake. There's no question about it. And it was a mistake. And I'll tell you that this is what happened was that my father... This was my father's best friend, and I was working at my father's best friend, and we're sitting down actually having Shabbat dinner this one night, and my father says, "Do you know anything about this union business at the Top Banana?" And I said, "I don't know anything about any union business, Dad." I was like, you know, I was like Michael Corleone, you know, So anyway, I knew that it was. I went for a long walk with my mother, a long walk in the neighborhood.
And you came back.
Well, I told her what happened, and she said to me, you have to realize why, you know, she says, I'm not mad at you. She says, you're going to have to come clean with your father, which I did. But she said, here's the reality. Reality is that irrespective of whether this is a terrible environment, in September, you're going back to University of Toronto. In September, you're not going to be around to face the consequences of your involvement in this whole union business. Everybody else is going to be still influenced by it, the people that you're associated with, the owner who's your dad's best friend. But no, you will not be around to suffer or experience positive or negative any of the consequences of your actions. None of the consequences of your actions will you face. You'll be back in Toronto. And that made me think a lot about responsibility, which, by the way, I'll tell you right now, I learned a great deal about responsibility from my parents. That's just one example now that you bring it up. That really brought it home. You know, this was basically, you know, this is 33 years ago, and that walk with my mother and what she said about responsibility and about success is really about living up to your responsibility and understanding that there are consequences to your actions, and that you have to face up to those consequences. And I mean, in my limited world called economic and financial forecasting, you can never, ever, ever do this in my business, which is hide behind a bad call. You never hide behind a bad call, okay? You basically have to, when my brother says, well, you're brave, you have thick skin.
I said you were intrepid.
Okay, but you have to, I'm going to be wrong. I don't intend to be wrong, but I know that as human beings, we have that certain frailty. We're going to be wrong. And to hide behind a bad call, instead of trying to explain why is it I was wrong, and this is what you have, this takes a certain degree of discipline, but it also comes down to responsibility. But this is what comes down to being successful, is taking responsibility. And that means that, you know, you're going to get your chance for glory, but when you're wrong and you have to face that embarrassment, to explain to clients why you were wrong and explain to clients what you intend to do to not make that mistake again. You may make another mistake, but what is it you're going to do in your thinking or whatever error you made in your judgment? What are you going to do to change that in the future? Because I'm in the business of trust, right? This is the money management business, which is what I've been doing, and money is very emotional. It's really about trust. So that, of course, is something that I can take all the way back to just this walk I had in the park with my mother about the summer job that I had, about what it means to be responsible and to face consequences. And if you're talking about, and if this is all about success, how you succeed, in terms of my experiences, you know, a lot of it comes down to, you know, obviously, I think there's a certain assumption that you're going to be smart or intelligent. You've got your college degree. But you'd be amazed how much comes down to personality. And I'm talking about character. Character in life will take you much further than your education. I don't mean to disparage the education, but your character...
No, disparage away.
Your character is far more important in terms of how you will all be successful.
Okay, so these are very important things. I want to take you now, we talked about youth and character. You finish your degrees and you get a starting job at a housing and mortgage company, and then slowly you work up through the ranks. I have a belief that when you talk to very successful people, they can identify at least one 10-minute event in their lives that helped make them what they are today. Did you have one of those 10-minute moments? I think I know what it is.
Yeah, I did.
That was the bar moment?
That's right.
Okay, tell my students.
Well, this was I started at Canada Mortgage and Housing Corporation, which is sort of like Canada's equivalent to Fannie Mae, in 1984. And so when I started on Bay Street, it was 1987, but what Mel is talking about was something that happened to me already 13 or 14 years into my career, when I was the assistant chief economist at the Bank of Montreal.
Which is a very big bank.
Yeah, and I had a great position there. And I used to do a lot of the morning meetings for the Treasury Group. What happened was that this fellow named Bill Down, who's now the CEO of the Bank of Montreal, back then in 1997-98, he had come from the States and they brought him into Toronto into headquarters to oversee all of the Treasury operations. Very big job, but now he's the CEO of the company and he's actually a phenomenal bank CEO. He sees me at an event and I'm at the bar where I usually am. I wasn't flying anywhere, but I don't know what other excuse I had to be at the bar having a scotch. But Bill Down comes up to me, and we were just meeting for the first time, and he says, you know, I wanted to say to you that I like your morning meetings, but you talk really, really fast. And then it's broken telephone. What did he say? So He says, I know you have a lot of morning meetings. You have the equity group here and the fixed income group here and the money market guys over here and the commodity group. He says, I know it's a crazy morning for you doing all these meetings. He says, why don't you get your morning meetings on paper? Get it on paper. Get your morning meeting on paper in print. He says, as a matter of fact, he said, this is how he said, he says, you know what? Call it something snazzy and we'll market the hell out of it. And so I said, well, I said my current boss at the time, who was Sherry Cooper, I said, well, Sherry's never going to go for that. And Bill said, you know what, leave Sherry to me. I want you to do this. And I remember thinking about it, and what an opportunity to start my own newsletter. Like, how nifty is that? I'm just going to take all my, you know, discombobulated thoughts up here, get it down on paper. And next thing I know, it's being marketed throughout the entire Bank of Montreal. It's being sent out to the media. Clients are getting it. And all of a sudden, I'm getting notoriety. And I'm getting quoted in the newspapers. And I'm going to see clients. I never saw clients before. Now I'm seeing clients here, clients there. And it just was, again, one of these things. And I was very passionate about it. And I think people could see the passion in the work. And I love doing it. And it's one of those things where, once again, the passion and then the results feed on each other. And that report, without that daily, I doubt I ever would have had the opportunity to get hired by Merrill Lynch back in 2000. So that was really...
Breakfast with Dave was a turning point.
That was an inflection point because it gave me a launching pad to blast out my views to a much broader audience.
Okay, so before we take a couple of questions, one of the things that students think, and I think that this is a mistake, is they think that either you get lucky in your career and you become successful, or you don't get lucky. We grew up in a family that was quite amazing, but certainly not famous. We were almost lower middle class. We lived in a small city in Canada. You got to where you were with outside of the top banana job with no pull. You did it all yourself. And I think that, like, to finish it off, what do you have to say about, what does luck have to do with it, to paraphrase the song?
Well, luck has a lot to do with it.
I teach my students that luck doesn't have anything to do with it.
Luck has a lot to do with it. Luck does, but the thing is that, but luck, it has a lot to do with our lives in general. I mean, there's good luck and there's bad luck. I mean, you just have to, like, look the wrong way. Okay, next thing you know, you just had a bus go over your foot. You know, so there is luck. I think that it's a matter of how do you maximize your chances of being successful? How do you maximize, because luck does enter into it, and it has to, because we're born, you could say we were born in lower middle class, but we certainly were not born into poverty, okay? And it's true, we weren't born into the wealthy class. There's no guarantee that whether you're born wealthy or born in poverty or whatever, it's a matter of what do you do as an individual to maximize your opportunities. So what do you do?
But David, doesn't have everybody have opportunities that they can maximize or not?
It's a matter of what do you do to maximize those opportunities? It means taking on initiatives, for example. When you get, like, you know, I consider myself, I get this job at the Bank of Nova Scotia in 1987. We didn't talk about, I started on Bay Street on the day of the crash, October 19th, 1987. Most people, I mean.
Not a good around. Day to begin a
But
career.
Most people don't even remember that day. 23% plunge of the markets. Now, I consider myself, I think that, did I work hard at getting that job at Bank of Nova Scotia? I was fortunate to be in a position to get that job. But then once you get that job, what did you do? Like, you asked me about this certain inflection point, which was my newsletter, which has almost come to define me in many respects. But a lot of things happened. I mean, that was the sum the aggregate sum of a lot of other things that happened. So luck does enter into it, because, and it has to, because we're not really born equal, okay? We're not born equal, so by definition. And you said before, I didn't go to Harvard. I didn't go to the best school in Ottawa. So by definition, yeah, you know what? The reality is that you don't pick your parents, and you don't pick your upbringing. So, you know, it's not equal, okay? We're not, you know, but the question is, what do you do as a person to maximize? I talked about, you know, displaying passion. When you're working for somebody, and unless you're self-employed, you're always going to be working for somebody. There's always going to be people that you're going to have to impress. And so displaying passion, you know, being diligent, responsible, trustworthy, being a team player. I said before, all you folks will graduate, that an employer will want to hire you, but he's got your CV and he's got your resume because he knows that you're smart. And you're not getting your job because you're smart. You're getting your job because your employer, when you're being interviewed, just know this, that they're looking for other characteristics beyond just your scholastics, which of course are important, but it's your scholastics that get you that interview. Once you're in the interview, and this is when you talk about luck, okay, you get the interview, you're lucky you got the interview. What you do with the interview and thereafter, that takes a certain amount of skill. Passion, diligence, responsibility, the ability, I'll tell you, the ability to show that you're a team player. The ability to show you're a team player, that is so important.
Something we don't teach.
Well, but these are all the skills. These are things that you'll learn. But that is what, you know, that is what will define your success, is being a team player, at least initially, being able to adapt to change, to juggle a whole bunch of balls, diligence, the work ethic, all these things. So you're right. Luck, to say that luck doesn't have anything to do with it, luck's got something. Luck will open up the door a few inches. Luck did open up the door a few inches for me. I was lucky in many respects. But to pull the door wide open and have a phenomenal career, then that takes a lot of sweat, and it takes a lot of doing things you might, you know, almost, in what they say in this business is punching your way through your job description, going over and beyond the call of duty, helping other people. This was a culture at Merrill Lynch that was so great that, you know, you could get ranked in the surveys, you could help make money for the firm, but you know what one of the most important determinants of whether you were successful at Merrill Lynch in terms of compensation, which is ultimately how you're always going to be graded, is how much money you make, how your peers, my peers at Merrill Lynch got to vote on me every single year. So, and that incentivized you to help other people. That's how an organization succeeds, is not by being in silos, but by encouraging, shall we say, you know, networking, commingling, and understanding about, you know, the sum of the parts being greater than the whole. So being a team player, that's what will make you mayachus, along of a lot of the other things that I was talking about too.
Wow. Hi, David, you know, like I've known you for how many, 53 years. I learned so much in this.
I'm not that old.
In this conversation, you said that you should speak the truth, no?
Amos.
Okay. So, you're talking, and I'm thinking that I'm going to change my lesson to the students. I almost said children, but for me, your children. I'm going to start teaching them about being a luck burglar. A luck burglar is somebody who goes down the corridors of life, right? And he checks the doors. Okay? And when he sees a door that's open 2 inches, he pushes through. We didn't talk about a sense of humor, because I think that your humor has been one of the main, I would say, one of the main enchanting things about you. And you promised me that we would sing a song in Hebrew for our students as a kind of a way of signing off here. Does anyone want to ask David any questions before we make fools of ourselves? Yes.
Question about the American market. What is going this year? Up, down, maybe you can tell us something.
Both. Well, that's the reality, is that it's been up and down about four different times this year. It's a sawtooth, and we're back to where we were practically on December 31st. There's been no change, but there's been all this. I think this year, I'll just keep this short. I think the markets will finish the year up by a little. And it's going to be more a stock picker's market than buying just the ETFs or the indices. So it'll be up by a little, but you're not going to make you're not going to have another 30% up year in the S&P 500. But I think it'll be up small. It's going to be really about being very selective in terms of what you own. And in my business, it's also identifying what you don't want to own. Not owning a lot of the junk is going to be very important this year. So I'd say focus on high quality stocks.
Yes, and my advice based on David is if you have lemons, make lemonade. If you have rotten bananas from the top banana,
Start a union.
What mom always did. No, bake banana cake. Any other questions before we sing? Yes.
I sense some little contradiction between some of the things he said, because, I mean, I would like to hear what you think of his contradiction. On one hand, you say that you need to be a team player, and this is a big part of success. On another hand, you say that you need to go against the flow, and you need to resist group dynamics in some cases. When you think it's not right, you need to be true to yourself. So how do you settle this contradiction?
Yeah.
Well, that's not what I said. I said that Mel brought up about what a reporter would say about me, or what the my point was that this is very important, especially in my world, is to make sure the noise doesn't influence you. But he talked about before. He says, "Oh, I was so upset reading in Time magazine that they were criticizing you."
Might have been Newsweek.
Or Newsweek. He says, "Do you care?" I say, "Actually, I don't." And then he got another thick skin. But no, but when you're part of a team, I mean, I'm not a one-person show. I have a team. It's a team forecast. Now, ultimately, if I'm the men of hell, if I'm the head of the team, I bear the responsibility. Okay? And I'm weighing people that work for me. I'm weighing their recommendations. But, you know, I've done this a long time, too, and sometimes I'll take something somebody says, and sometimes I won't. Sometimes I'll take somebody else on my team. Like I said before, you know, what's changing that's going to cause me to change? And sometimes there's changes, and I just think it's a wiggle along the line. But sometimes the whole line's changing. That's something different. But you can't be so arrogant as to rule anything out. So there wasn't, but, you know... In terms of, that's why there's really no contradiction, because when it comes to group dynamics, you have to listen to what everybody is saying on your team or within your firm, and then make your own judgment. You know, ultimately, who's going to wear the forecast? I'm going to wear the forecast. Person X, Y, or Z, they work for me. Their role is to, you know, as a group, come up with the best forecast. But someone's got to bear responsibility. And that's the team leader. And that the mark of success is not to shut anybody out. And just because you don't listen to somebody or you don't pay it, you know, it doesn't mean you don't want to invite them for their advice. Because at some point, if you shut them out, you'll never know what their advice is. And there might be 6 months later, you might want to listen to their advice just because you don't want to listen to their advice today. That's why you have a team. But you have to make a decision. Like, you have to be one of the things about success. You've got to be a decision maker. You've got to take a whole bunch of people's views. And, you know, you got to then make up your mind, you know, which way are the risks going to be balanced? And you have to make up. So, you know, my role is to really exercise judgment. And because I trust this forecast in Time X, I might trust another one in Time Y. But you never want to make somebody feel disenfranchised. You never want to humiliate anybody. You never want to make somebody feel that their contribution was somehow not relevant just because at that particular time, you didn't necessarily accept their view, because 6 months from now you might. So there was actually no contradiction. But what the outside world thinks, now if a client comes back to me, a client comes to me and has a problem, then I got a problem. But I got some reporter out here that writes, let him write what he wants to write. You're an economist in the public eye, you know, provocative, you know, you got a role, and you got to take the good with the bad. So they want to write something about me that isn't so complimentary, chaval. You know, so let's move on. There's no contradiction. That's just basically what a reporter says, with all deference. You know, it can go both ways, but that doesn't, you know, the important thing is not to let outside influences determine your view. Let your team help you determine your view. So actually, they're mutually compatible. Just, you know, I listen to one and not the other. But thanks for the question.
Any other questions before we sing in Hebrew? Max?
Yeah, I have...
Short questions. Thank you, Max.
Only the answers are long.
Yeah, I was trying to imply, but it's all right.
You talked a lot about the DNA, success, and about being successful.
Well, that's what he talked about.
Yeah, he talked about that. He used to do that a lot.
His DNA.
But I really want to know, what's your definition of success?
Oh.
And the other question is, how you can get positive contribution to your success from the success of your peers?
Well, you know, ultimately, I'm going to keep this as short as I possibly can. I have a responsibility to Gluskin Chef clients and to the people that subscribe to my newsletter. So success in that definition, professionally, because there's other definitions of success, how you are as a person, or how you want to be remembered. But look, my goal is to help people make decisions. Okay, my role is to help and the people in our firm, not just our clients, subscribers, but the people at Gluskin Chef, the portfolio managers. How do I help them through my skills make effective decisions? But I'm in a very limited role here. I work in wealth management. Our goal is to help people make money or save money. So in that particular aspect, if I know that I actually did a lot of great homework and we made a very good decision on the behalf of our clients, or I have subscribers come back to me and say, boy, you really helped me out in terms of making a decision for my kids' education or interest rates or whatever. I mean, that's what I do. So that's how I define, you know, success is how I help people make decisions from a money management standpoint. You know, I don't know so much about the second question about the peers. It's just basically that's just a recognition that you should never get so arrogant as to think that you know it all, okay? And that's what I love about my industry, is you're wrong just enough to keep you humble.
Yes, Itai.
I saw a TV show last month about the Israeli linebacker. He made it to the NBA. And this guy is not big, not a big athlete. And the secret, I don't know if you call it a secret, everyone told about him, that he just walks hard all the time. The first guy in, with the left one out. And that is his secret to success. Do you agree that walking hard and not having any special skills can make you, being a small player in Israel to be a player in the NBA?
He's not 5'9", though.
Yeah. He's about that. He's not very tall.
Well, you know, that might be what he said. Well, I imagine, and I don't know who it is you're talking about, but he probably has a very deep skill set. And you're saying he's a basketball player. Well, it's impossible to be an exceptional basketball player, successful, and not be a team player. Basketball, by definition, is a game where you have to pass the ball. So I think he's being overly humble, you know, my opinion. Work ethic is one of the building blocks. The whole thing about success, think of the pyramids. And it's just you're building one on top of the other. The work without the work ethic, you know, but the work ethic isn't there if you don't have the passion. And if you're not a team player, you're never really going to succeed unless you want to be your own person and be your own boss and run your own company. But most people don't. Most people actually work in an organization where you'll only be successful if you have team building, team playing skills. So you really need the whole, it's like, you know, when you eat a stew. You've had stew before? You've had stew? You've eaten stew? So, you know, you got peas and you got carrots and you got potatoes and you got meat. It's a whole collection of food. That's what makes stew so great.
It's our a whole mother, shakshuka,
our
right?
mother, our mother made a great stew. And so that's basically what it is. And it's hard to know individually what will override what. But work ethic is, it's like I said, work ethic, absolutely. And there's a lot of other things. And of course, if you're going to want to take it to the next level of being a leader, and I'm not going to say that that you can still be successful and not be a leader, but it depends on what your goals are. But you need to have exceptional communication skills. And that's what I bring it back to, having the ability. And again, I didn't get a chance to choose to have siblings and parents who knew how to teach. Okay, but again, that was a building block for me. And maybe one of the reasons why I was able to lead a team of economists at Merrill Lynch was because I had communication skills that I could bring to bear to make us all successful. And a lot of that I bring right back to my family, my great brother.
I will just close in saying that, I'll take one more question in a minute, that you were a great kid, but nobody ever expected too much of you. And we had to change our projections time and time again. And about 4 years ago, I was at an internet conference in the States. And I was talking to someone, and he wasn't particularly nice to me. But when he found out that I was your big brother, you're David Rosenberg's brother? Wow, can you send him an email on my behalf? And that's when I knew that you were the amazing Dave Rosenberg. But I think that we've forgotten one thing, and that is sense of humor. I think that in the whole stew, your humor and your ability to, although you're a very serious guy and you dressed up in a tie and I came in a tie.
Well, you told me to. Remember, I do what I'm told.
Yeah. So we are now going to sing a song in Hebrew, but I suggest we change the last word to Na'ara. Because I still have to work here even after you're gone.
Okay, I'll try to remember that.
Okay, are you ready?
1, 2, 3.
Are you going to go up in the harmony?
Sure.
Okay, 1, 2, 3. Lo tov, lo tov ra meod, lo uchal laset zotot, afilu zvuv rotze zvuva, az lama ein li na'ara. Lama eli, lama eli, eli na'ara. Lama eli, lama eli, dag al hachaka. Ze lo echpat li, im tiye razai o shmena. Ha'ikar she tiye na'ara tova.
I'll stick to my day job.
Chagai, yeah.
Oh, here comes the tough one.
Yeah. We
off the record, of course.
We heard everything about you. Tell us something about Mel that we don't know.
that you don't know.
Oy vey.
Okay, so here's something that you don't know about Mel. That and it says something about me as well. Was this? When I was a little kid, we had this very soft American football. And I was probably about 5, Mel was 14, and Mel would kick the ball in the air on our front yard, and I would catch it, and he would tackle me, and then he would put his nose in my belly button and tickle me till I was pishing my pants laughing, and then he'd say, go stand there again. And he'd kick the ball way up high in the air, and I'd catch it, and he'd come and he'd tackle me. He'd stick his nose in my belly button, and he'd make me giggle and laugh till I pished my pants again. Then he would kick the ball again way up in the air, and this went on and on and on, which just comes down to what I said before in terms of being a success is don't make the same mistake twice.
I would even bet. It's a take. Anybody want to say something off camera? Yes.
About the risk of success. Sometimes to make success, you have to take some risk. What you can say about the dimension of risk? How many risks you take to make success?
It always comes down to. And this is the one thing you learn in statistics, if you take statistics, is that what is the cost of being wrong? I benchmarked against what is the reward of being right. So if you're going to take a particular risk, but you know that if I'm wrong, I'm going to lose 5%. But if I'm right, I'm going to be up 40%. you know, in terms of, I mean, for a portfolio manager, they'd want to know stuff like that in terms of what they're going to do, in terms of how they're going to position themselves. But you can apply that to life as well. You can apply that to life. What's the risk of being wrong benchmarked against the potential reward of being right across this whole probability curve, which is just the distribution of outcomes? So there's no easy answer to your question. Each individual decision that you make, and it's not just about finances, but every decision you make is going to have consequences. And the consequences are often unknown. And in my business, we're forecasting the future, which by definition is unknown. So that's what you have to do, is you have to be very cognizant and aware of what is your downside risk and what's your upside potential. And that's basically it. So there's nothing wrong. I'll take on big risk if I know that, if I'm wrong, actually, this is what I, if I know what my potential loss is, but what I know my potential reward is. Or maybe I'll just ignore. If there's a small, let's say there's a small chance, you know, that I could lose $1 million, but if I'm right, I'd only make $300,000, you know. That's a risk I'm not willing to take. And then there's some risks that you're willing to take. Some big risks you're willing to take, and then there's sometimes the small risk you're not willing to take. And it all comes down to expected values.
Okay, now...
If I didn't answer the question, then I'm doing my job right, because after all...
No, great answer. I think that we're semi-off camera, so I want to thank you, Dave. We never really had this discussion. And I was careful not to have the discussion with David before we did this, so that it would all be fresh. And I heard a lot of new stuff that I never knew from this guy. I hope you guys enjoyed it. We will meet after Passover. We have the Pirate Day to plan. And this is going to be the home of amazing television interviews at HIT. And also, I hope, the home of creative thinking. So I want to thank everybody. Wish everybody a happy and kosher Pesach. You too, Brother Dave. And I think that we made some kind of history today here at HIT. And thanks for being part of that.
Honored to be here.